Good afternoon, this is Professor Victor Ponce, and this is class number 042, CIVE 638, Sedimentation Engineering. And the subject today is more of sediment production, the second lecture, second session. We're gonna have two more sessions on the subject next week. I already discussed the universal soil loss equation, which is the equation that is normally used to calculate sediment production, not sediment yield. I already explicitly discussed the difference between them. And I applied the calculator too, so that should be okay. And I did talk about the experience that we had in Tijuana with the aguaje de la tuna that eroded to rock, to the tertiary rock. In only one night, in one evening, one day, one early morning, actually. 400 cubic meters, 400,000 cubic meters of sediment were removed that night from the aguaje de la tuna and deposited at the mouth. Where is the mouth of the aguaje de la tuna? Right in the middle of Tijuana. Okay, so we already got through this. I believe we stayed in here. Sediment yield. So sediment yield is the sediment that is developed or delivered downstream. And as you know, I already said this, but let me repeat it because it's very important. Not all the sediment is delivered because nature has to go about creating the valleys. And if you delivered all the sediment downstream to the ocean, there would be no valleys out there. But the fact of the matter is that we have valleys everywhere. Why is that? Why do we have valleys? And the answer is because of sediment transport. The sediment transport is such that when the slope diminishes or decreases, the sediment also drops, the capacity for transport also drops, and therefore they're setting the deposits. Because if it were not like that, it would, the entire sediment load produced at the uplands would be delivered to the oceans. And we wouldn't have any sediment. Therefore, we wouldn't have any food because the food comes from the sediment. I think that is clear. So nature put it together in the way she only knows so that we could have the sediment and we can have the soils, we can have the valleys, we can settle the valleys and so forth. Imagine the Mississippi. I already talked about the Mississippi. I think I did say that in lower Mississippi has about a 7,000 feet alluvium deposit over rock. 7,000 feet. Why so big? Because it's a huge basin. Lucky. The United States, lucky that they got the Mississippi in the middle of the country. Well, not in the middle, a bit off to the right, but still. In a sense, the United States as a country is lucky that it has a diversity of geomorphic situations and climates also. The only thing we do not have in the United States is tropical weather. Actually, there's an exception in Puerto Rico. There's a very small area in Puerto Rico, not the entire island, but the very small area. I can't remember where is it, north, east, south, but that it rains just like the tropics, 3,000, 4,000, 5,000 millimeters, and therefore it's considered, but it's very small. So one could claim or say that in the United States, including Puerto Rico, there is a little bit of tropical country, like tropical rainforest, but very small. Other than that, we don't. We have temperate forests in the eastern United States. We have prairies in the middle, and we have mountains in the west and so forth. And then California. California has everything, absolutely everything. Golden State. And that is a plus also. Not only that, but I mean, we have got to consider the fact that as far as resources and wealth is concerned, California is doing very well. Now, at least now, I don't know in the future, nobody knows the future, but at least now we are very, very well off compared to many other states in the United States from economic standpoint. That's all I'm going to say at this time about that. Sediment delivery is the ratio between sediment delivered or yield and production. And that sediment delivery is a ratio which can be calculated from an empirical or conceptual standpoint. Remember, we talked about that already. There's four types of hydrologic or sedimentation engineering approaches. Deterministic, which is the kind of stuff that Einstein used to do with his method, although he didn't do it completely deterministic. He introduced a little bit of stochastic components into their method. But we have deterministic, number one, number two, stochastic, number three, conceptual, and number four, empirical. And we extensively talked about that in the other class, but I know many of you or a few of you are not taking the other class. So I have to repeat it. So the sediment delivery ratio typically is an empirical value because we have not been able to determine too much about it. However, there's a conceptual model, which I'm going to show. It is part of one of the technical reports that the US government has put together over the years. It is a very good graph in here that I'm going to explain. It says, relationship between sediment delivery, let me increase the size a little bit. Relationship between sediment delivery ratio and drainage area. Is this true? And the answer is yes. The larger the area, the more the chances for sediment to deposit. That we know because of the geomorphology. And therefore, but you can see that that is a conceptual model because it doesn't really tell you the equation, it just tells you the trend of it. But it does say that if the drainage area would be 1/10 of a square mile, which is exactly 64 acres, because 640 acres equal a square mile, so 64 acres, and you will have a delivery ratio of about, I'm reading off in here, maybe 52% will be delivered. That means 48% retained. But if you get to 1 square mile, it'll be about 40%, and if it's 10 square miles, 10 square miles is about 22%, 100 square miles is about 15 or 16%. But note, of course, that this is just a trend. It doesn't tell you exactly. I mean, if you had to choose, you can have that variability in there. Now, I didn't develop this equation. It's in reference 44. I'm curious at this point, reference 44. USDA Soil Conservation Service, National Engineering Handbook, very authoritative publication. Very authoritative publication. And yet it doesn't tell us the details, of course. Now, where am I now? I got lost. There we go. In here, we have an example, the raw formula for sediment delivery. But all these formulas have to be taken with a grain of salt because they are totally empirical. Anytime you see an equation that has a bunch of odd numbers or numbers in the coefficients and the exponents, that is a statistical fit. It is only worth as long as you're applying it to the local situation or something could be considered to be similar. In this case, for instance, Roll developed this formula for the Southeast Piedmont region of the United States. So that's the Piedmont, it would be West Virginia, a place like that. I'm not familiar exactly where the locations. I believe I have read this paper. Everything I cited, I read, but I mean, it's been 40 years, right? They have allowed me a little bit of latitude. I don't remember everything. So at any rate, that's one formula. The only reason I put that formula in there is to show what is being done out there. However, there was a gentleman by the name of Dendy and Bolton. And I believe Dendy and Bolton equation, let's see what number was that? I am missing this stuff in here. Hold on a minute. Dendy and Bolton formula, 13, formula 13. So over here in the references, Dendy and Bolton, 1976. So I thought it was much older. No, 1976. So Dendy and Bolton, and we're going to take a look at this Dendy and Bolton formula later on in more detail. But Dendy and Bolton studied sedimentation data from about 1,500 reservoirs. They were working, I believe, for the federal government. And they came up with this equation. There's two equations to Dendy and Bolton. In the first one, they said that the sediment yield was inversely related to the 0.16 power of the drainage area. So the greater the drainage area, the lesser the sediment yield. And so forth. And we know that for a fact already. And over here, they also related that to mean annual runoff. with these formulas that I show in here. And finally, Dendy was an engineer and Bolton was a statistician. I'm sure they worked together and Dendy said, well, this is what we're gonna do and this is the data and please manipulate the data and find me some good relations. And so they did. And they came up with this relation, which is over here, 1311 and 1312, which are not only good, well, they're good in the sense that they're better than anything else that does not exist. I mean, they are the only ones that this I believe, it's an empirical method, really. It's an empirical method, but it's based on a concept. So I would call it half conceptual and half empirical. And I'm going to describe the concept that Dendy and Bolton used, okay? And I think it's a very good concept, by the way. So Dendy and Bolton studied sedimentation data from 505 reservoirs, having mean annual runoff data. So they wanted to answer the question, this basin with mean annual runoff, what is the mean annual delivery of sediment? That's the question that they answered. The annual sediment yield per unit area, because they have the areas anyway, was shown to increase sharply as mean annual runoff increased from 0 to 2 inches. And thereafter, the mean annual runoff decreased exponentially. So this is fascinating. Just imagine what's happening in here. Dendy and Bolton said that based on the data of 500 reservoirs, sedimentation data from 500 reservoirs, there's a lot of reservoirs throughout the United States, they came up with the conclusion that if the mean annual runoff is from 0 to 2, it goes up and it gets high as the mean annual runoff reaches 2. Then after that, it starts decreasing. And it decreases exponentially. So there's two. One, the first one is like a power function. It goes up and up and up until it hits a top, and then the bottom is like an exponential. So it's like a very peaked mountain over there that peaks at 2 inches. So 2 inches appears to be the threshold at which the sediment starts to change. Some other process comes in and takes over. The first process is without vegetation. And the second process is with vegetation. And as we know, the more vegetation, the less sediment is delivered anyway. So they were conceptually correct in what they did. They had based their work on or work that had been done by Leopold and Woolman and other people and some of the great contributors that had basically done work that was related to what Dendy and Bolton did in 1976, much earlier work. But the point the comment I'm going to make in here, this is very interesting from our standpoint, because mean annual runoff, what is mean annual runoff? A lot of people know the issue of how much it rains. I mean, you can find that out easily, almost online even these days, how much it rains annually in a place. Well, we know for a fact that talking in inches, 30, 31 inches is the mean annual precipitation in the United States. The precipitation is 31 inches average. I'm sorry, not in the United States, throughout the world. It's a mean annual global terrestrial precipitation. Terrestrial because it has to be in the ground. The precipitation in the ocean is a little higher. We're really not concerned because we're not going to be harvesting the ocean rain, right? But we could harvest the precipitation that falls into the terrain. So the number is 31 inches global. How much is it in the United States? Well, it varies. It doesn't matter for me to talk about the water amount of water in California when I have to use it over in Ohio or elsewhere, Maryland, right? We don't have the capacity to move that all that water. Water can be moved, but we cannot move it across the United States because that would be too expensive. We move it throughout California. We have two large reservoirs up north, Shasta and Oroville. You may have heard of those two large reservoirs that were built in the 60s with the State Water Project. Those, we drink water from those reservoirs here in San Diego. About half of the water that comes to San Diego comes from the north. It's all piped and pumped, by the way, piped and pumped, sent through canals. The California Aqueduct is a big, huge canal which carries maximum discharge is about 16,000 CFS. It's a big, huge canal that goes all the way from Northern California to Southern California and delivers the water. But interestingly, because the Southland California is so developed and there's so many thirsty people over here on the order of 15 to 20 million, because California just reached 40 million people, of which 20 million live in roughly 20 million. Yeah, I would say at least. You can go back and Google this number. 20 million live in the South, Los Angeles and San Diego. The areas and all the towns around it. Los Angeles itself has about 60 cities. In San Diego, 18. So add those, that's 78 cities, plus all the other cities that are now within Los Angeles and San Diego, they need a lot of water. How much water do they need? Well, that's an interesting story and question. The number is about, 200 gallons per person per day. That's what the state and municipalities figured out that they have to do. So they feed us 200 gallons per person per day. That could be considered enough, or it could be considered a lot, or it could be considered too little. That doesn't matter. The point is that that's what the number is right now. That in the future, they may have to, one may have to, or the state would have to decrease it because we're running out of water. That's another story, and that I'm not here to talk about that. I'm here to talk about the dirty water, not the clean water. But the point I wanted to make was that since the water that's coming from the north is not enough, then we need to resort on the Colorado River. So we bring the water from the Colorado River. Also, we pump it over here. But there's a problem, and I do want to mention this because it's interesting and also important, that the Colorado River water is saline. It has a ppm, parts per million, on the order of 800. While the water coming from the north is clean. It's about 100, 150, very clean water. The cleanest, one of the cleanest, well, actually, I should say this, the cleanest water in California is in a river up in very close to Oregon, where the ppm is only 80. But 80 is the cleanest you could find, actually not. In Michigan, there's a Lake Michigan, I believe, or Lake Superior, has only 60. That's the cleanest water in the United States, Lake Superior. But over there is 80, 100, 150, normal, but the Colorado is 800. So we had to come and fix it. Now, we couldn't desalinize it because it would be too expensive. So what we did is we mixed it at about, I'd say it's mixed half-half. So the water that we drink here in San Diego that comes out of the tap is about 470. Interestingly, Google that and see if you can find it. Good luck. I have not been able to, you know, I've been looking for this number for a long time, and I know the city and the county know, but they don't put it out. They don't like to put it out. At any rate, the point that I'm making in here is that Dendy and Bolton developed this formula, and then they zeroed on these two formulas, 13A and B, 13A and B. These are the two formulas that everybody uses in order to calculate sediment yield off the bat if you only knew Q, which is the runoff, and A in the area. A is easy to find. The Q, I was going to refer to it, is the runoff easy to find? And the answer is no. Typically, if you have 2 inches of runoff, that's probably 1/6 to 1/7 of the total precipitation, because it depends on the ratio between runoff and precipitation depends on the weather. If it's wet weather, it goes to 20-30% easily. If it's dry weather, it could come down to 5-3%. So if you're in the middle, it's about 15%, which is the standard over here, not the standard, but the measure. So 2%, 2 inches is about 1/6, roughly, right? I was figuring this out this morning, in order to lecture today. So we figure two inches runoff is about 16 inches precipitation, which is kind of dry, but not too dry. San Diego, let's say, what is the precipitation in San Diego? Where is interesting? Lindbergh Field is 10 inches per year on the average. Ramona, 15 inches. And Mount Laguna, 20 inches. But if you go across Mount Laguna onto the other side of the basin, then you reach Imperial Valley. And the Imperial Valley is only 2 inches. It dries out completely and immediately because of the issue that all the rain is wrung by the hills, even though the hills are not that high, but they still act to get to all the moisture that's coming from the coast and return it back to us, San Diego County. That's the story. But that's okay. Let me go back. Let me not get sidetracked in here. I have a tendency to get sidetracked. So these are the formulas. These are very easy formulas and readily applied. And we have a calculator here to apply the formula. It says calculate the sediment yield by the Dendy and Bolton formula for 150 square mile watershed with 3.5 inches of mean annual runoff. Okay, so we're going here, 150 miles and 3.5 inches of mean annual runoff. And we're gonna come in here, and that's the formula we already know. And the calculation is 210,000 tons per year. That's exactly what it says in here, 210,000 tons per year. So you can see how easy the Dendy and Bolton formula is. Being so easy that there's a tendency to misuse it or abuse it. And the answer is, so be it. There is no other formula in such ready shape for us to apply. So a lot of people use this formula because there's no alternative, or comparable, I guess you could say. There's no comparable alternative. The Army Corps of Engineers recommends this formula in their manuals. Army Corps, for sure the Army Corps. I know the Army Corps does. I'm not sure of SCS. SCS, well, let me not say anything about SCS because they're kind of, they've been upgrading their manuals. Right now they're looking at the upgrading of the NEH4, what used to be called NEH4 manual. They went ahead and changed it to 660 or something like that. And they're still reviewing it, and they take a long time to do their things. Okay, so let me just say that at this point, I'm finished with Dendy and Bolton. And I'm not gonna do VO2 because it's an old video, but you're certainly welcome to look at it. The contents are good. It's just that Professor Ponce, that's Professor Ponce in the year 2011. And I already done one, I believe. But let me just proceed in here, the Dendy and Bolton. The paper, the original paper by Dendy and Bolton. And I'm not going to cover it in detail other than to state the important parts about the Dendy and Bolton. This is what they say, and I'm going to read only this first part in here. Many variables influence sediment yield from a drainage basin. They include climate, drainage area, soils, geology, topography, vegetation, land use. The effect of any of these variables may vary greatly. Previous studies have indicated that sediment yield per unit area, this is what they're looking for, are generally decreases as drainage area increases. Okay. They're talking about how they're going to do their work, but eventually they zero into the work of Langbein and Shum, showed that sediment yield per unit area increased effectively, peaked at 12 inches. This is fascinating. They talk about precipitation, and then they say 12 inches. Remember, earlier we said that finally they talked about runoff, not precipitation, and they zeroed at the peak at 2 inches. Okay, so what these people did is, I believe, is they took the study by Langbein and Shum, and then they kind of reduced it to the data that they had. Interestingly enough, I should tell you that Professor Shum was one of my professors over in Colorado. A distinguished, very well-known and very prolific fluvial geomorphologist at that. And fluvial geomorphology, as you guys know very well, is one of the sister sciences of sedimentation engineering. We could not do sedimentation engineering without knowing very well fluvial geomorphology and the meanders and all this sort of thing. So it's all kind of related. I remember that when I was in school, Daryl Simons was teaching river mechanics and Stan Shum was teaching fluvial geomorphology. And they were talking about the same subjects. The only difference is that Daryl was talking about river mechanics and throwing equations at us, while Shum was not really amenable, I guess you could say, he didn't throw as many equations or that many equations at us. The reason, of course, at the time you could have thought about it, but the reason is obvious. The geologists usually don't handle the mathematics as well as the engineers do, because we were trained to do the mathematics from the beginning. They were not. So that's the difference. So at one time, I remember somebody described it, or they described it themselves. I believe Simon said it, right? He said that he was the quantitative geomorphologist, and the Stan Shum was the qualitative geomorphology, but they were talking about the same thing. And in fact, they were. Great gentlemen, by the way. I was really lucky that I had a chance to work under their wings, under their wings or tutelage or whatever the word is. Okay, so this is the basis, the beginning of the work that Dendy and Bolton did. They have the sedimentation, the data rather, the U.S. Department of Agriculture, I already told you that, 1,500 reservoirs. They looked at the data. They chose about 800 of these water bodies, sediment yield versus drainage area. They zeroed into the easy. They wanted to do something that was conceptual, right? So they did. They exactly did that, and then they got the relationships. Let me see, where am I? Over here. No, over here. No, not over here. Over here. I got lost already. I think it's over here then. I'm sorry, I got lost. Okay, it's this one over here, right. Let me just go to the second one and then I'm gonna stop there because at this point, I don't think we can return. We can return to the arrows, I think. But these are the formulas, that's it. We already covered this ground already. Look at the locations of the reservoirs, they cover the entire United States. So again, this formula may have its detractors, but they're not too many. Most people, like myself, agree that you get a lot of bang for your bucks. You put in a little effort and you get a whole lot of stuff. But don't forget that this is a conceptual model done gathering a whole lot of data. So individually, it may deviate from the actual situation. How much? 10%, 20%, 30%? I would say even 50%, I wouldn't be concerned about it. Because like I already told you, sedimentation engineering has a way of varying a lot. So 50% error would not be considered out of whack at any, in any reason for imagine that 50% is intolerable. No, not at all. So that is what I would like to say about the Dendy and Bolton formula. And what I want to do now is I want to proceed in here. The calculation we already did, the universal soil loss equation, we already did the universal soil loss equation for composite watersheds. We did that on Tuesday. So now we're going to move on to a slightly different subject. All the subjects that we're covering here do deal in one way or another with sediment. But in here, we're going to be talking about runoff and sediment and flow and surface flow and base flow. I hadn't talked about base flow before, but base flow is fundamentally and intrinsically related to sediment. And we'll explain how that connection is done. Okay, so universal soil loss equation, no, in here, Camp Creek photos. I should say at this point that, and I repeat it, and I don't have any problem repeating it, and I am, Professor Ponce is a very lucky guy. I always had good projects and learned a lot from it, and they benefited me a whole lot, and therefore I am teaching all the stuff that I learned in the field. Now, I have very little book knowledge. Most of the stuff that I know is from the field, from experience. Okay, and I'm going to tell you a story from 1989. In 1989, I was, the summer of 1989, I was looking for a project because I had nothing to do, and I don't want to have to do nothing. I created projects for me, but 89 was a little bit low, and I was lucky that there was an RFP that came out from, Pacific Gas and Electric Company, and they had a research and development arm at the time. They were doing very well. Not, they're not doing well anymore. It's been 30 years. But at the time, they had a complete building that they dedicated to research and development. And there was a lady out there that had been doing quite a bit of work in base flow. And she funded. She put out an RFP that stands for Request for Proposals for people around the states to compete for a certain amount of money. Not a whole lot, but it was a certain amount of money, enough for people like me to move, okay? So I remember I applied, thinking that, well, you know, there's a 1 in 3 chance. I'm gonna put my best mind in here. So I applied, I put a little proposal, you know, it was not a long proposal. I applied and sure enough, I got it. I got the contract. I believe it was $60,000, if I'm correct. At this point, it's been 33 years now. And the lady, her name was Donna. Donna said, I asked Donna, I said, I was curious, how many people competed for this project that you're giving me? And she says, none, you were the only one. So I figured, oh boy, yeah. So I said, well, this is an interesting subject. How come? I said, I'm curious that nobody applied. And I was lucky that I got it. I was the only guy running for the job. And she said, you know what, Professor Ponce? Base flow is something that people don't know. And since they don't know, they don't want to get into it. And therefore, that's why I put together this contract. I want people to learn about base flow because I do believe, that's what she said, I do believe that it's very important for the sediment movement and so on and so forth, and the water, and that she talked a whole lot about it. She obviously had a lot of experience. And I, of course, I'm revealing to you today that I jumped into it because I had nothing to do that summer. And another thing that interested me was that I considered at the time, I had studied enough and had become already environmentally kind of tuned into the environmental situation, that I decided that floods was good, but it was not the only thing. That there had to be a problem with base flow, and base flow was not floods, and floods was not base flow. And I considered at the time that it was like two sides of the coin. It was the same coin, only had two sides. And depending on which side came up, it was floods or it was base flow, because we know enough that to know that if an iota of water goes into floods, it does not go into base flow, right? So that we knew at the time. So we decided to get in. Well, we actually got the contract. We had a 2-year contract. I think it was the first year was 60 and the second one 50, something like that. But we did have this money. So we hired a whole bunch of students. The idea was, that was Donna's idea, to do not leave stone unturned in terms of the issue of base flow. And at the time, there was no web. The web, the online capabilities came about in the year 1994. So we didn't have any web out there to help us. So I hired up students, 2 or 3 students, and ended up spending particularly that summer of 1989 in the library, in our library. And our library is good and was good. Now, of course, now it has been deserted. As you know, in the last 10, 15 years, who goes to the library? No, because the library went ahead like everybody else, put all the material on the web, and you don't really have to go physically to the library. You could, but you don't have to. You can get it directly, virtually online at home, right? So therefore, we went over there, spent 3 months with a couple of my students, don't remember their names right now, and we dug everything out that could be dug. And we came up with about 150 references, which I thought at the time was nothing, because if you look at flood references, you could find 10, 20, 30, 50,000. And even to this day, I would venture to say that if you Google floods, you will get 40 million, 20 million. And if you Google base flow, you'll get maybe 20,000. I haven't done it recently, by the way. I've done it before. I'm gonna do it after class, okay? And so there's a lot less, three orders of magnitude difference between the amount or the body of knowledge in floods than in base flow. Why is that? Because society puts their money on floods. People get employed and working with floods. There's very few people employed in working with base flow. 1 to 100 or 1 to 1,000, by the way. Engineers don't get hired to work on base flow. They should and they will, but they don't at the time right now. So we looked at base flow, and the idea at the time was the concept of base flow augmentation. So we were not looking at base flow just because base flow, but we wanted to augment base flow. Because we felt that the more base flow, the less floods, and the less sediment movement, because it all tied to the sediment movement. We didn't want to move all the sediment out, because we knew that if we move the sediment, we would lose it. It will go to the ocean, or it will go somewhere else and cause trouble somewhere else, okay? So the first thing I wanted to do at that point was to figure out who had talked about base flow augmentation in the year 1989 to 90. And research the literature and couldn't find hardly anybody. But the first one that showed up was this project, the Camp Creek Project in the Crooked River watershed near Prineville, Central Oregon. And so I quickly went over there, contacted the boss, the head of the project. I believe his name was Wayne Elmore. Yeah, that's right. He's since retired, subsequently retired from the Bureau of Land Management 5 years or 10 years later. And I don't really honestly know if he's still around or not. I have not kept in touch with him. But Wayne was a great guy. He was considered to be the first riparian specialist of the BLM. The BLM, you know the BLM. The BLM is the Bureau of Land Management, an agency of the Interior, I believe, of the United States. They own and manage all Western lands that are not private. Because the way the United States developed was that, you know, a couple hundred years ago, no, not even a couple hundred, the 1850s to 1900, when the Western United States was settled, it was not like in the Eastern United States where everything was settled for 200 years, everybody owned the property and this plot of land belonged to somebody. Over here, you know, I don't want to get into the story, but the history, but the point is that there was a lot of land that had no property owner. So the United States took upon itself the management of these government lands, federal lands. And they created an agency to take care of that. That's the Bureau of Land Management. Now, the Bureau of Land Management employed Elmore, who I believe was by a range manager by training. Who is a range manager? A range manager is a person that manages the range. How funny, repetitious. The range is an area which is not forest and it is not agriculture. It's right in the middle, a smack middle. There's forests, tall trees and everything, then there's range, and then there's agriculture, and then there's urban. Those are the four ecosystems, if you want to call it that way. So the range is in the middle, and Wayne Elmore was a range specialist with the Bureau of Land Management, and eventually he pursued the issue of riparian vegetation. And he became, I don't know the details, but the point is that eventually after 20, 30 years of work in riparian sites or ecosystems, he was mentioned, or the story that I got was that the BLM did an evaluation and they changed the categories of their employees and they named Wayne Elmore the first riparian specialist of the BLM around the late 80s, 85, 86, 87. So this was his project, Camp Creek, the one that he had worked on and he had talked about and also written on it. He and I believe Professor Vechta, who was with Oregon State at the time, if my memory serves me right, wrote that paper that I read. It came to my hands because I was researching the subject and I decided to go visit him, and I visited him twice. I visited him in the year 1889 and then in the year 2004. These pictures are from 2004. What actually had happened there was an interesting story, which by the way, I'm not gonna get into because we're gonna go details later on the raster, meaning on the report. Okay, but I just wanna show you some of the pictures here. Camp Creek near Prineville, Oregon. So what actually happened was that around the turn of the century, I don't know exactly when, meaning the previous century, say 1880, 1890, 2000, when this area was being settled, okay, this Camp Creek did not exist. Simply it was not exist. The level over here was above, was over here. In the period between the 1900 and 1930 or 1940, it eroded, it created the gully. The gully was created in 20, 30 years. Why did this gully create? And you know, I think I already mentioned to you that gullies are cancers. They come without knowledge, or not too many people know why they're there, and therefore they don't want to go away. That's like a cancer, okay? And eventually ruins everything. Everything in terms of ecosystem support and everything else. So this Camp Creek over here developed exactly the times, I do not know, but I believe it was between 1890 to 1920, okay? And it carried a whole lot of sediment out, and then it deposited downstream in some place which were very much ad hoc for the deposit. I'll show it to you later. What happened before this thing was there? It was a meadow. It was a grassy meadow, meaning a flat land where the groundwater was very high. That's why it was a meadow, because a meadow has vegetation and the vegetation needs some water. And since these are semi-arid, area in central Oregon, because you know Oregon east is very wet, but then it changes completely into semi-arid. So without the groundwater being high, within a couple feet from the ground, the meadow was not going to be able to sustain itself. But what happened when this creek, or rather, it's called Camp Creek, but it was a gully, developed all of a sudden at the turn of the century, about 110 to 120 years ago, it lowered the groundwater. It lowered the groundwater about 15, 20 feet, as you can see, a little more than that, actually. And the groundwater and the meadow disappeared. The meadow started suffering, and then it disappeared, and it became sagebrush. You see the sagebrush over here? That's sagebrush. It's not meadow. The meadow is what the cattle could eat. Animals, in general, feed that meadow. But sagebrush, my understanding is that cattle don't eat sagebrush. They would if they were against a wall, but they don't really. And people don't want to put their cattle against a wall. At any rate, now what actually happens, though, I should mention to you in case you're not familiar with, there's three types of animal husbandry in this region: the cattle first, then the sheep, and then the goats. And it's a progression. The first, or the good guys, or rather, I guess you could say, the comfortable guys, are the cattle. But once the cattle find it difficult to survive, then the sheep move in, the sheep herders. And once those in turn find it difficult to survive, the goat herders move in, or the goats, that's it. The goats and the goats herders. Because the goats will eat just about anything. It doesn't matter, they're very selective. But you cannot teach a cattle herder to do sheep or goat. They it runs in the families, you know? So it's a difficult thing to change. Long story made short, we investigated with Wayne Elmore and Roger Becht, I believe, how is it that this was formed? And it was formed because there's two reasons in here. There's drought, and the other one is overgrazing. Now, you can have drought and nothing happens. You can have overgrazing and nothing happens. But you have drought and overgrazing, that's when the things start to move. And that's what this happened around the turn of the century, coupled with overgrazing and drought. So the overgrazing is anthropogenic. The drought is not. So the issue is, when is the drought coming? And that's the answer, which, by the way, I have a conceptual model of frequency of droughts throughout the world, as a matter of fact, which we don't study here. We study it in hydrology. So those of you that are taking hydrology this semester will hear me talking about a conceptual model of droughts. But droughts have a way of coming back. And depending on the spectrum, it may be every 3 years, or 5, or 10, or 20, or 50, or 100. It depends on where you are. But that it does come. Only that if you're in the Amazon, the drought comes every 100 years and it lasts only 1 year, so nobody notices it. But if you are in the middle of the country, Idaho, for instance, is the location that has the most persistent droughts. Not the most frequent, but certainly the most persistent, because droughts have three characteristics. They have intensity, duration, and frequency, just like floods. Droughts have the same. And we have actually created a model of intensity, duration, frequency of droughts, right? So droughts are bad. Are bad because people don't like it when there's no water. And I just got through, in the last couple of days, watching the movie by Ken Burns. I don't know if you guys know who Ken Burns is. He's a great guy. He's a cinematographer of documentaries. I believe he's linked to PBS. And I just watched the last couple of days his famous documentary on the Dust Bowl, which I, by the way, urge all of you to go find out. I don't know exactly how you do it. I don't do that. My wife does it. I'm sorry, I don't know everything. But you pull it out of whatever television, and you actually have to pay. I believe you pay a couple bucks for it. And then you watch it. I just watched it recently. I intend to watch it again because it was a great documentary. Needless to say, Ken Burns is some of the best in terms of in his field. But that's exactly what happened. What happened was that the people abused the country, abused nature, and nature took off and came back with hardships for 10 years. They had a drought that went on so long, 10 years. Normally it's not supposed to be that way. But I should mention to you that I've studied this extensively, and it's been said that the longest droughts recur in Idaho in locations similar to Idaho in the middle of the country, where the precipitation is about 800 millimeters, right? The middle of the climatic spectrum. And they have the longest duration and therefore the most intense, because the drought is a summation of several years. And if you sum up 5 years, that's more intense than 3 years or 2 years. So the longer and the more intense, therefore the more intense, the worse the drought is. And it really depends on who you are and what you're doing. If you are a person that derives your income from agriculture, you're gonna suffer, as happened with the people in the Dust Bowl. The center of the Dust Bowl was a location called, I learned this a couple days ago, Boise in Oklahoma, or Boise City in Oklahoma. That was the eye of the Dust Bowl. Go back and read that. I think everybody should go and take a look at that video because it's interesting. And it was all based on unsustainable practices, which, by the way, this is something that is coming back to haunt us throughout, unsustainable practices. The word sustainable was created in 1986 by the United Nations. Sustainable meant the opposite of unsustainable, because we were doing unsustainable practices. Even to this day, we continue to do it. Hopefully in the future, perhaps not when I'm around, people will decide that they have to go back to basics. You have to respect the workings of nature. The people that settled that area in Oklahoma, in the panhandle, the Oklahoma panhandle, did not respect. But that's of course they did it because they didn't know. Subsequently, this is interesting, fascinating in relation to our study, that the Soil Conservation Service, the great agency of the US government, with whom I have worked extensively, they gave me jobs in the 80s and the 90s. I had very good friends out there. Don Woodward was one of my friends, or he continues to be my friend, he's still there. Was created by the federal government because of the Dust Bowl. Had there been no Dust Bowl, the Soil Conservation Service would not exist, okay? There is no Soil Conservation Service in Peru because they never had a Dust Bowl. Does that make sense? I don't know if it makes sense, but it makes a heck of a lot of sense to me. Okay, once you have something really bad, you have to come up with something really good to fix it. And the Soil Conservation Service was good. And the movie by Ken Burns, reflects upon that the scientists from the Soil Conservation Service, they were the best of the country, they were hired to do this, they spent a year looking at it, and they came up with a solution. Okay, the erosion control practices, which the other people had not done because they were just farmers, they didn't know. And since then, of course, we have had better luck in handling the soils of this country and the erosion and the dust and the winds and stuff. I actually had known about the Dust Bowl because I'm an informed person, but I didn't know all the details. I learned the details through the movie by Ken Burns. But let me just say at this point, by finishing this discussion or this commentary, that this was the first project that I reviewed, because there was in here baseflow augmentation. Can you see the baseflow a little bit in there? How'd they do that? Well, they figured that the cattle, because there's still cattle over there, although much less than what they used to be, but the say 10% of cattle that remain in the last 100 years, they had a tendency to go into the creek and to trample the creek. And therefore the creek was never going to improve if it was trampled, meaning compacted by the hoofs of the cattle. So then the Bureau of Land Management, in conjunction with all the other people that were working in this project, decided to fence the place. Just fence it so that the cattle would not go in. And sure enough, they did. They did this in 1968. In the year 1990, I believe it was the year 1989, 89 or 90, that I went there, they had recovered this about 3 or 4 feet already. I'm not sure of the figures, but it was recovering. And then I decided to go 15 years later in the year 2004, And I could estimate, I didn't measure it with a ruler or with a tape, but I could estimate 1 or 2 feet of recovery. If we extrapolate that to the top, it would take maybe 50 to 100 years for the whole thing to go back to the way it was. It's a slow process. But it's a slow process because we didn't want to, we, society, didn't want to put in the money in there to fix it completely, because this is a place that hardly nobody ever gets there, only the people that live there and so forth. Okay, so they probably didn't have the resources or money to fix it completely, but they decided to put a little patch in there to fix it. And I am positive that it will get fixed because it is going up. The problem is that not that many people are out there documenting it. Elmo retired. I'm ready to retire. I intended to go there for the third time in the year 2019, but I did not go because I didn't have the wherewithal. I don't go by myself. I never go anywhere by myself, because something could happen and so forth. Besides, you need people to help you. But the point is that somebody should take the this project and continue to document it into the future to see what is the rate of replenishment, because it is replenishing. The issue is, when is it going to finish the replenishment? So you can explore these figures. They are all great figures, okay? The year 2010 on the issue of Camp Creek. And over here, the end of the story is that there was a reservoir downstream of Camp Creek. This reservoir no longer exists because all the sediment that you can see in here came from Camp Creek. And why did it settle in the reservoir? Because the reservoir had a dam over there. They had a dam that they were using for agriculture. This is the dam. Can you see that? Fantastic, isn't it? This is the dam. And this is the overflow spillway and so forth. Well, the whole thing filled up. So this particular reservoir first was a water supply reservoir back maybe 30, 40, 50, perhaps more, even more, maybe 70 years ago. Then it got filled up with sediment that came from Camp Creek, because Camp Creek is say 10 miles upstream of this place. So where was all that sediment going to go? It was going to go where it could settle, and it settled over here. I'm sure a little bit passed through, but most of it settled. You can do a calculation, you'll see that in fact it did settle. And finally, I lost it. Okay, here. And the last one is this one over here, which even shows a little better. The dam, the overflow spillway, and the settling of the sediment into the reservoir. So finally, the reservoir became an ecosystem, I should call it like in recovery or something like this, or a new ecosystem. You know, the word ecosystem basically did not exist in our common usage dictionary prior to 1890. It was after 1890 that everybody started developing and talking about ecosystems. I know people, particularly the ecologists, would disagree with me. But I'm asking them, who there was not an ecologist talked about ecosystems before 1989 or 1990? Nobody. Not even Professor Ponce. Okay, we learned the word and then we started using it and we liked it. Ecosystem, you know, ecosystem is the system that nature put together. And of course, it's a system that we need to learn how it works so that we can respect it. If we don't know how it works, then that's a problem. Okay, I should also tell you, because it will come up, that it was through the process of this study that I became aware of the work by Alexander von Humboldt, who was a long story made short, a German scientist who decided to go to, in the 1802, decided to go to South America in order to study the rainforest and all the ecosystems of South America, which of course the Europeans knew nothing or not much about. And since he was a scientist and he had the resources and the money, he said, I'm going to go out there and spend 5 years and learn everything. And then when he came back, he wrote a book. Actually, it's an encyclopedia. He wrote an encyclopedia of 7 volumes that he called My Personal Narrative, of everything he knew. And he put everything he knew in there. Interestingly, though, that this was 1803, 1804. This was about the time when then mechanics had already been developed by Newton 100 years before. But chemistry was in its infancy. Lavoisier was still around, but biology was in its infancy. So he was one of the people that is credited with developing botany or contributing extensively at the beginning of botany, classification, and so forth, in biology. And he put all that stuff into his book. But interestingly enough, because I read that book twice over the course of my career, because I thought it was interesting and fascinating, he talked just about everything. He was an interdisciplinary gentleman. He is referred to in the literature as the last Renaissance man. Let me repeat that. The last Renaissance man. Why? Because after he studied everything, then people started studying only one thing instead of everything. In other words, Humboldt was not limited by fields. He covered any field. If you go to read his book, and he jumped from here to there like nothing, like 5 pages on this field, 5 pages in another field, and he's got 2,000, 3,000 pages to complete, right? And he did that over a period of five years, working in the field. Okay, so that was Humboldt. So I learned about Humboldt during the course of this study. And I thank God for that, because he really, I became a better person after reading Humboldt and many other people that I have read, not just Humboldt. Okay, so let me go in here. I am here over here. So Camp Creek photos. Now Camp Creek photos, 89 and 2004. I already told you that I went to Camp Creek twice. I decided to go in the year 2004. So now I'm going to show you the comparison. There was a gentleman in Arizona who developed this technique of taking pictures of one site 20 years later. And he actually wrote a book on what had happened to the riparian ecosystems all over Arizona and the Southwest. He was from Arizona. One day his name is, I believe, Weld or something like that. My memory is a little bit off at this point, but I remember I did find that he had written this book, which I thought was fascinating. And since I had used some of his pictures, I decided to call him up once. He used to work for the GS at the time, Geological Survey. So I decided to call him up and I talked to him on the phone and I said, I would like to purchase your book. Send me your book and I'll pay for it. And he said, Professor Ponce, I'm going to send you the book right now. You don't have to pay for it. So I got it and I've got it somewhere out there. It's a fascinating book because it's got a couple hundred pictures before and after, before it happened and 20 to 30 years later, after the effect, after the anthropogenic action, because that's what happens. We move in, society moves in without really, really knowing everything. We know, but we don't know everything. So we go in there and we move and we do some things and 10 years later, it comes back to haunt us. That's what happened in the Dust Bowl. What happened in the Dust Bowl? I don't want to get too much into the Dust Bowl because it's a kind of a related subject. But what happened is that back in the late 20s, people moved in there in great quantities to settle and to farm, and they decided to farm wheat. Well, whatever reason, I don't know. I wasn't there. So they farmed a whole lot of wheat. And they changed the ecosystem, and nature got mad. Because the original ecosystem was a prairie, it was grasslands. And they changed it to agriculture, and that's different, totally, completely different. And that was not, the weather didn't like it, and then you can lift the soil easier, much, much easier. So then they had this dust storms and so on and so forth, and history has been told on that. And they suffered a whole lot. For 10 years they suffered. Eventually the drought went away. Nobody knew when the drought was gonna go away. And it was the longest drought. I already told you that in Idaho, extensive studies had shown that the droughts in Idaho are 5 years, 5-6 years. I have that in my book, in my writings. So how is it that this Dust Bowl drought lasted 10 years? And the answer is anthropogenic. The anthropogenic action can exacerbate the severity of a drought. The same thing happened in the Sahel in Africa. And I'm not gonna get in there because that's a 1 hour talk. But if you're interested, go Google the Sahel, S-A-H-E-L. Another story on sediment production, by the way, the subject we're talking about today. The Sahel sits right below the Sahara and above the African tropical rainforest. So the tropical rainforest, precipitation 2000. And in the Sahara, precipitation 0. So there's two ecosystems, if we want to call it ecosystems, are together, but the nature doesn't go from zero to 2000 in no space. There's a certain amount of space in there. So there's a gradient between zero to 2000. And that is called, that location where the gradient is, gradient in annual precipitation, it's called the Sahel. Go look it up, Google if you're interested, Google it and find out what the Sahel is. And it's interesting, I don't like to, Sahel sounds really bad, and I didn't invent the word, but the name is S-A-H-E-L. It's a portion of Africa, which sits between or lies between the Sahara with zero precipitation and the rainforest with 2,000 or more, okay? And in the Sahel, they had a drought event in the 70s, which of course, it was supposed to last only 5 years or so forth. But the drought in the Sahel lasted 17 years. So the drought experts all over the world went out there to find out exactly what had happened. How come this drought didn't want to go? And Charney and many others that studied this, and I've studied this because I've written papers on the subject, decided that it was an anthropogenic problem. Meaning it was human-induced, human-caused. I don't want to get into details because it's a very extensive discussion. But let me just finish at this point in here, wrap this thing up. Just a view of Camp Creek in Central Oregon developed in the late 1800s due to overgrazing of the meadow. That is clear. Since 1968, exclusion of livestock managed by the BLM had led to the buildup of the stream bed, which continues to date. Top photo taken in 89, bottom photo taken in 2004. Channel bed aggradation in the past 15 years is estimated to be about 2 to 3 feet. Let me just clarify the issue of overgrazing. Some of you may not be familiar with it. Having born and lived in the city all your life, you don't know what overgrazing is. Now, what is a cowboy? What does a cowboy do? Of course, you heard of the cowboys. I mean, the Westerns, you know, Clint Eastwood and all these people that pretend to be, with no disrespect to Clint Eastwood, I think he's still alive, right? At any rate, but the point is that the cowboys are charged with eliminating or avoiding overgrazing to the extent possible. That's what they do. They move the cows around so that they wouldn't trample the ground and they would have enough food. Because if you trample the ground, then you have no food and then the cows die and the cowboys are out of a job, right? So that in defense of that, they have to make sure that the grazing is never overgrazing. So overgrazing is a very important word when you talk about animal husbandry, cattle, sheep, and goats, particularly that, okay? Interestingly though, and this is really fascinating, that the fact that the first group of animals in the rangeland or in the grassland are the cattle. Because they are the more selective, the bigger one, they like the spoiled a little bit, I would say. If you could use the term spoiled, they eat the best food and that's the way it is. And the farmers, the cattle herders are like that too. But when things start getting bad and they're not that much food anymore and so forth, the situation, the climate is drying up, then there's a move or there's a transition or a conversion from cattle raising or herds of cattle to herds of sheep. The sheep are the ones that come in later, or the second stage, so to speak, in the degradation of the range. And then lastly, once the sheep figured out that they can't really survive, or the people that are raising the sheep, then they move out and then the goat herders come in. And the goat herders, the goats are animals that are just basically accustomed to eating just about anything. I was in Bolivia once, and Bolivia has arid country, it has everything actually. Arid, like Peru, it has everything. It has tropical country, arid country, high country, etc. And I saw one day, I don't remember where it was, but it was in Bolivia, in central Bolivia, a huge goat, because you know goats are in different size. You can have small, medium, large. Goats that had climbed on a tree. The tree wasn't too big. It was just a regular small tree. It had climbed on the tree and it was eating the tree out completely from the beginning to the end. He wasn't going to be satisfied until the whole tree was done. So that could give you an example of the stage that between in the range use and management is from cattle to what did I say? Sheep and then goats. So I'm going to finish there. So this photo taken, okay. This is another photo here. A view of Camp Creek in Central Oregon developed in the 1800s due to overgrazing of the meadow. Okay, so this is the same thing, estimated to be 10 to 15 years. I'm going to say that at this point that I wish, and I will, since I'm going to be not too busy in the next few years, maybe head out there, find some good people that would go with me and head out there and look Elmore up if he hasn't really gone to heaven already, or if I haven't gone to heaven, and do a third stage of this research of how is Camp Creek recovering from the misuse of the 100 years ago, 100 to maybe 50 years ago. It was in 1968, I believe, that this whole thing started to be fixed. 68, 50, so it's 54 years so far. And my impression or my feeling is that it is being fixed only slowly because people are not putting money into fixing it quickly. So this is the Camp Creek photos. And then the next article is in the Camp Creek base flow augmentation. And then there is this case studies of base flow augmentation. And I do want to say in here that when we did that study in the year 1989, we were able, with the luck that we have, to identify four projects where people out there working for many years had already experienced some base flow recovery. And this was Camp Creek, the lead project, Sheep Creek Barrier Dam in Utah, Alkali Creek in Colorado, and Trout Creek in Colorado. So I decided to go out there and visit with the people that had developed or their descendants, because some of these projects are 50, 100 years old, and it's hard to find the data. So Camp Creek is the first one, and I'm not going to do it right now because we're running out of time, but this is what we're going to read next, okay? But I do want to say that eventually the study that we did for PG&E in the year 1989-1990 developed into a report. I had to write a report. I mean, that was part of the game. Write a report on everything you have learned or everything you have researched. And like I told you, we found 150 references on base flow, which I consider to be a ridiculous amount. I figured I'm going to get rich on this one because nobody knows. If there's 150 references throughout the world, then nobody knows about this. Compared with floods, 20,000, 30,000, even more. I'm going to do something interesting now with your permission.
Yeah, we see the Google page now.
Floods, right? What does it say in there? 1,180,000 references. Okay? Now we're going to do droughts. This is going to blow your mind. $64 million. So there's about twice as many references on floods that there is on droughts. Why? Because society puts more money into floods. Everybody's talking, writing, working, and then there's for production of material, right? Literature material. Now let's go to base flow. $2 million. 2,790,000. When I worked, well, I cannot say that. I would be lying. I didn't do this in 1989. We didn't have Google at that time. Google came about in the year 1998, I believe, roughly. Okay. So I have proven to you that there's 1.1 billion references on floods, 500 million on droughts, and 2 million, actually almost 3 million on base flow. So base flow is now coming up, but it'll never account for as many references in floods and droughts. Why? Because society doesn't spend a whole lot of money on base flow. Right now they are beginning, but it's going to take a long time for people to realize the importance of base flow. That's going to take a long time. So let me just finish there. And now I'm going to go to the baseflow augmentation. I wrote this report called Baseflow Augmentation by Stream Bank Storage. What happened? There we go, I lost it. Baseflow Augmentation by Stream Bank Storage. And I do want to mention at this point, at the end of this class, that I became so fond of Mr. Humboldt that I used a quote on his book, Personal Narrative of Travels to the Equinoctial Regions of the New Continent, in the preface or the beginning of my book, on the summary of my book. And I'm going to finish this class by reading what he said, which I thought was fascinating because it was the first time that I, being a PhD trained Colorado State hydraulic engineer, hydrologic engineer, I never had the subject put in these terms as Humboldt had done 200 years ago, roughly 200 years ago. And he said this, when forests are destroyed, the springs dry up entirely or become less abundant. So he was making a relationship between the forest and the springs. The riverbeds remaining dry during part of the year are converted into torrents whenever great rains fall onto the adjacent mountains. The sward and moss disappearing with the brushwood from the sides of the mountains, the waters collecting from the rain are no longer impeded in their course. He's basically saying you're converting base flow to floods. Instead of slowly augmenting the levels of the rivers by progressive filtration, meaning base flow, they further in heavy showers, meaning create a lot of sediment problems. The side of the hills bear down the loosened soil, create those sudden inundations that devastate the country. Hence, it results that the destruction of forests, the want of permanent springs, and the occurrence of floods are three phenomena closely connected together. He had to be humble who said that. But then for 200 years, we forgot about that until I brought it up. I'm saying I brought it up because I hadn't seen anybody else that talked about this. I'm sure there's people out there, but they're not really well recognized. So with that, I am going to finish at this point and I'll pick it up. I'll pick up the details of this report next time we meet next Tuesday. Needless to say, if at any time or whenever you have a question of any origin related to the subject matter or the course itself, you can contact me. I'm completely available to discuss these issues with you on a personal basis. Thank you very much. I will see you next Tuesday.